It's been a lot, man. I want it not just for myself, but for everybody in that locker room.
Coach, I'm trying to calm down, coach.
You don't have to calm down.
This is nice and all, but we're going for Larry for sure.
Everybody stays ready, everybody stays locked in, and that's all you can ask for.
Knowing Giannis, he'll probably be back at some point in the series. This really is it. This is the last 7 games.
We still have work to do.
Here's Jalen Rose. I'm David Jacoby. We are Jalen Jacoby. What is it that we do?
No days off, baby. We get the people what they want.
Jalen Rose, the day is finally here tonight, 9 p.m. Eastern on ABC. It is game one of the NBA Finals. And of course, NBA Countdown will get you ready for that. But we will get you ready here on Jalen and Jacoby. Jalen, obviously the biggest key to this series is the health of Giannis Antetokounmpo. He is doubtful. He will likely not play. But outside of him and his impact on this game, what are the keys that you are looking for in game one of the NBA Finals?
I'm rooting for the big fella to get healthy, and hopefully he gets a chance to appear in this series. And I want to make sure I shout out Giannis, and I want to make sure I shout out Devin Booker. You know I'm a really loud voice when it comes to making sure players who get drafted by a team, especially if they're elite, all NBA caliber players, I appreciate when they stay loyal to those situations and they get paid off. This happened for Devin Booker. People were asking for him to be out of Phoenix. This happened for Giannis. People were asking him out of Milwaukee. So for them to both be in the finals is terrific for the league. With that being said, after 16 years, the story is Chris Paul, David Jacoby. That's the story. Just think about it like this. Chris Paul, when he got to the Clippers, they were a lob city. He had to reinvent his reputation because they didn't get it done. He went to Houston with James Harden. Some dubious things happened. They didn't get it done. And like a seasoned veteran, he had to go to Oklahoma City and replay for his value, not only as a player, but as a leader and as a game changer. And that put him in position, along with the fact that Devin Booker was outstanding and Phoenix was 8-0 in the bubble, to add Chris Paul, to add Jay Crowder, veterans, to go with Ayton, who's a terrific young big, who's been outstanding in this year's playoffs. Mikal Bridges, Cam Johnson. Cameron Payne was out of the league. And the poise and the discipline Chris Paul plays with, not only just the way he closed them out in the fourth quarter with the oohs and ahs and the buckets, but how about keeping his composure when Patrick Beverley lost his, including the push, because that could have became a melee. And we could be talking about all of the people that are suspended for the NBA Finals, not just the fact that Patrick Beverley got suspended for one game.
That's a really good point. I don't consider that because I remember people online were talking about how the Suns should have reacted to that. But I love the way the Suns reacted, because why waste your time on Pat Bev when you are facing the Bucks in game one tonight at 9 p.m.? One of the things that I'll be keying on is something that was very crucial to the Bucks-Hawks series, which is, what will the Bucks defense do against the pick and roll? Remember game one, they got torched. Brook Lopez was dropping back, and they weren't switching at all. Over the course of that series, they started switching more and more against Trae Young and his pick and roll. However, when CP3 has the ball and DeAndre Ayton is the role man, there is a very versatile duo right there. So if you drop back your big, CP3, where is he best shooting from? Oh, that's right, the elbow. You can't give him that shot. And if you switch, then expect DeAndre Ayton to eat on the smaller defenders of the Bucks. And without Giannis, I don't think Giannis is going to play, but even if he does, he won't be 100%. Can they keep Brook Lopez in the game? Do you remember game 5 of the last series against the Hawks? Brook Lopez looked like the best player in the league. He was dunking on everybody. He was cutting. He was not just standing on the outside shooting threes. If you can get that Brook Lopez, that can give him a chance. But can the Suns play him off the floor with the pick and roll? That's what I'm looking at.
I think they can. I think they will. And you don't really scrap what you've done. You're in the NBA Finals. And also, Brook Lopez is a 7-footer. His mobility is going to be challenged against some of the best perimeter players we have in the league. Guys like Trae Young are wizards with the ball. So absolutely he's gonna struggle. But here's one of the things. DeAndre Ayton and Chris Paul hooking up as an assist combination is one of the tops in the league. CP3 and Devin Booker are also amongst the top five in the league at making mid-range buckets. So while the pick and roll against Trae Young is played a lot different because he has an unlimited range. See, he can shoot from the hash mark. He can shoot from half court. You don't really see Chris Paul and Devin Booker doing that as their forte. So for Brook Lopez, I think that allows him to still stay in the game, be a guy that can take Ayton as a roller, but more importantly, play dominant in the paint. Play like a seven-footer. We saw him earlier in his career play with his back to the basket, play mid-range, and be a 20-point scorer. But as the league evolved, players like Brook Lopez evolved, and he started to shoot more threes to spread the floor for Giannis. But they're going to need he, Bobby Portis, Chris Middleton, Drew Holiday, all of those guys to get points in the paint like they were doing in the previous series to close out.
Absolutely. And as we've been leading up to this series, it's been so much time and dissecting all the matchups and looking at the online stats and analytics and reading the stuff. And one matchup that's come to light that's really important in this series, and that is Chris Paul versus the referee Scott Foster. If you cover the league closely, you know that this is a rivalry that is dated back years and years and years. But Chris Paul in playoff games that are officiated by Scott Foster, he is favored in 7 of the 11 games, and he's lost all 11 games. That is not a coincidence. Jalen, do you think that this sort of hype around this matchup will affect the way that the NBA selects when Foster appears in this series?
Not at all. You see he's officiated 11 of Chris Paul's games. You see it didn't stop at 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, or 10. Scott Foster has proven to be one of the best at what he does. Chris Paul is clearly a Hall of Famer. And also, Chris Paul, along with being talented and a terrific playmaker, I think what people forget about him that I love, he's also an irritant. Like, all of the things that you love about Patrick Beverley, Chris Paul is a lot of those things, too. It's just that he's a much better basketball player. So I don't think that Scott Foster officiating the game, per se, is going to change the way the Phoenix Suns and Monty Williams approach the game. However, for Chris Paul, it's going to be in the back of his mind when those 50-50 calls go against his team. But I think the Phoenix Suns are going to be ready to stay focused and stay disciplined like they did in the previous series.
That's a really good point. Now, Jalen, you know that you are the best NBA analyst walking this planet. However,
thank you, brother.
I am ESPN's senior broken nose analyst, and I have noticed something about Devin Booker. I've had my nose broken so many times that I'll tell you what, them closing out the series a little bit early is going to make him feel better. He hasn't really been the same ever since he broke his nose, but those 3 days off, those 4 days off, then the swelling goes down, the nose feels a little bit better, you feel a little bit more confident about it. I'm expecting the old Devin Booker to come back tonight in game one, having
we
a big game. And that is
back.
Not just my opinion as a co-host of Jalen and Jacoby, that's my opinion, as the senior ESPN Broken Nose analyst. We have a lot more about Game 1 coming, but we're going to turn our attention to international basketball for a second. Luka Doncic and the Slovenians have qualified for the Olympics. Congratulations to them. And Luka said it would mean more to win a gold medal with this Slovenian team than it would to win an NBA championship. What do you think of those remarks?
So if you're a die-easy human being, like my brother, the handsome David Jacoby, you might not get this. But for somebody that's 10 toes down with the 313, that bosses up before every show, that says, what up, though? It means more to me to get the love from my hometown than the rest of the world. And by the way, it would also mean that they beat Team USA, which is an amazing accomplishment in itself. So I understand exactly where he's coming from. They're not going to win a gold medal, but I understand why he feels like it is going to be more important to his home country than it will be to win a world championship with the Dallas Mavs.
I agree with that. I feel like if you're Luka Doncic, you go to sleep tonight, you expect to win multiple NBA championships by the time you hang up your sneakers. But I think that he's looking at this Slovenian team will always be a huge underdog in the Olympics, and having the whole country at your back and that plane ride home and that parade that they would have will surmount anything that you can do in the relatively small scale of an NBA championship, which he expects to win. Jalen, it is now time for one of my favorite clips we've ever had on this show. It is Soft Move or Boss Move. Jalen, this impressive video of Lil Uzi Vert breakdancing is in its own right something to be celebrated, because I don't think there are too many MCs walking the planet today that have that kind of uprock, this kind of floor work. However, this video has nothing to do with the breakdance moves of Lil Uzi Vert. When you watch it again, watch James Harden and Meek Mill in the background. James Harden and Meek Mill in the background are having a tickle fight. Jalen Rose, being at the club and having a tickle fight, soft move or boss move?
Definitely a soft move, but I got to make sure I shout out Lil Uzi, because so many times OGs don't give the young G's credit for being historians of the game. Good and point. I'm pretty sure he's probably one of the only people at his age that is doing an uprock, that is doing a windmill, that are doing flares. Extremely impressive. If somebody who grew up breakdancing and had the little breakers only cardboard and used to keep the zip up so you could be sliding in the hoodie when you do your head spin and your back spin, a little eyes eye pouch around your waist, and wanted to be like Lee and B Street and Powerful Pecs and Lil Lep and Crush Groove and Turbo and Ozone, that's classic by Lil Uzi Vert. But come on, Meek Mill. Come
How
on,
ticklish
Harden.
Is Meek Mill?
Y'all
how ticklish
a
is
fight.
Meek Mill? My man was like on the ground, hunched over. Like, how ticklish is Meek Mill? That's my big takeaway from this. Meek Mill is an extremely ticklish human being. Everyone's
one
got
word.
Their thing.
One word. Number one, that's what happens when you're extremely rich. You're just laughing for no reason. They're just rich, Jacoby. They're laughing for no reason. The second thing, medicinal. You're also laughing for no reason.
Well, Aaron Rodgers doesn't want to play for the Packers, but he is still laughing for no reason. He told us about his offseason. Look at this man. He ain't worried about football.
He's living his best life.
We'll be back right after this. You're watching J&J.
He's sucking that tummy in, eh?